Okay, we're now joined by the Iowa State coach, Matt Campbell. Coach, welcome, and your thoughts about the upcoming season.
Sure. First and foremost, just extremely grateful and thankful to be here, represent Iowa State Athletics, our great university, and you know, really fortunate to come with four great representatives from our university. On the offensive side, David Montgomery, our junior running back, our senior quarterback, Kyle Kemp. On the defensive side, Brian Peavy, a senior cornerback, and then our junior defensive lineman, Ray Lima. And, you know, four anchors to the foundation of building Iowa State's football program, and really excited to have those four with me. You know, for myself, I was really anxious to watch the response of our football team coming back in January from some of the lessons we learned from a year ago. And for the last 7 months, it's been really fun since January to where we are today to watch the leadership of our football team and the growth of our football program continue to grow in a real positive direction. I know, like every coach here, we're really excited to get the 2018 football season underway, but really proud of our football team. And certainly any questions you may have from my end, I look forward to answering.
Okay, we'd like to remind you, if you would, when you ask your question, if you would stand and also give your name and your affiliation. We're ready to take questions. We'll take one on the outside. Brian Field be first, and then we'll come over to the inside.
Hey, Matt. Brian Baldinger from Fox Sports. I got two questions for you, Matt. One, despite only one returning offensive lineman coming back, you said at the end of spring that you thought for the first time you look like a real offensive line. So I wanted you to address that. And then addressing the loss of Tom Manning, and what that's going to be like for you and really Tom's future with Indianapolis.
Sure. First of all, the offensive line position. You know, Brian, one of the great challenges for our program in general to make a step forward has really been rebuilding that offensive line. You know, for the last 2 years, you know, we've had to really rebuild it from the ground up, and that's not a quick fix. One of the things that is neat for us is there are four guys that have started football games. You know, Bryce Meeker, who started 8 games a year ago for us at right tackle. Josh Kniffel, who started all 13 games at right guard. Julian Goodjones, who started all 13 games at center, but gives us some position flexibility across the board. And then Sean Foster, who started about 6 games at left tackle and right tackle for us last year. So, you know, there are some guys that have actually played for us, which is really big. It's the first time since I've been there that we've got that many guys that have had experience and played. And I do think that's really big in the offensive line world, is you got to play and you got to get that experience and you got to have some of those failures and some of those successes so you can grow. But I think that's a real positive for us, though I still think it's a great challenge. This group's got to prove itself, and they've got to be willing to take the next step. You know, Coach Manning leaving was certainly, kind of twofold. Number one, he played for me. He's been a part of my coaching staff since I've been an offensive coordinator. So really proud, to be honest with you, was my remark when he had the opportunity that came his way in Indianapolis. You know, Tom is a very bright young man. He's a coach that coaches his players with a lot of passion and energy. And so I think for Tom, his future is as bright as he wants it to be in terms of what route does he want to do. Does he want to become a position coach in the National Football League? Does he ever want to be a head coach down the road? I think he's positioned to do any of those things. From an Iowa State standpoint, we're really fortunate that, you know, number one, that my background has never veered too far away from the offensive line position. Obviously, you know, that's where I was able to cut my teeth in coaching that. Had a very similar hire in terms of Jeff Myers as what we had when Tom Manning became the offensive line coach for us at Toledo, promoting a graduate assistant to that position. You know, with Tom being the offensive coordinator, a lot of the day-to-day operation of our offensive line fell on Jeff's shoulders. Jeff played for us, was a 3-year starter at the University of Toledo. And so he's been there, he's done that. He knows what expectations I have and what expectations are laid on that offensive line position. And really, it's almost been a seamless transition that way. So it was great to have a guy in-house that had the same core values and beliefs that I have of what that offensive line position should look like and feel like.
We've got two questions in the center. We'll start first. Right, go ahead.
Hey, Matt. Jenny Carlson with the Oklahoman. Had a question about Kyle. The fact that he came in, started midstream last year at OU, was so successful. What were the challenges for him to do that after so long not starting? And what do you think allowed him to be so successful, not only then, but then throughout the rest of the season for y'all?
Yeah, great question. You know, I think number one for Kyle, you're talking about a young man, 4.5 years of college experience and 3 plays prior to that. San Jose State the year before, he got a couple reps at the end of that game. And, you know, to be honest with you, in our society today, what young man, especially at the quarterback position, is going to wait that long till he actually gets an opportunity to prove himself? I think that says everything that maybe we need to know about who Kyle is as a person. And, you know, college football is about taking advantage of your opportunity whenever it comes. And usually that's what defines success for a student athlete in his collegiate experience, is when your opportunity comes, are you prepared to take advantage of it? And that's the one thing I've always admired about Kyle. And to be honest with you, it's the one thing that really gave myself and our staff confidence moving forward, that Kyle always prepared as if he was the starting quarterback. His preparation in detail was elite. And I think that's what really allowed him to not only have success when he stepped in as a starter, but I certainly think it's what's allowed him to continue to have success through the rest of last football season. And I think that's also the reason for me that it was so exciting to be able to get Kyle to come back when he was announced that he was going to get a 6-year, knowing that somebody that represented the game of the football the way Kyle does, and how I think trusted he was by his teammates because of the work ethic that he does embody. I think that was really huge for Iowa State football and certainly for our program going forward.
Another question in the same location, Barry.
Barry Trammell with the Oklahoman. Matt, going back to that game in Norman, you guys won. It propelled you to a really good season, but we've got some perspective behind it. What did that victory do for your overall program, not just the perception from outside, but maybe the confidence and belief level inside you to go to a place like that and win? What did that do for the Cyclones?
Well, you know, I said this about Iowa State football the last 2 years. Year one, we had to learn how to believe. What does real belief look like and feel like? And I think as you saw us in year one, you saw our kids really grow, but they started to believe that they could win. In year two, we had to learn how to win. And, you know, we learned that by obviously some successes in some football games that maybe we weren't picked to win. But you also saw it in some tough, gut-wrenching losses that we had throughout the year as well. And I think, again, winning a game like we did against Oklahoma, it showed us and our kids that here's what it takes to be successful. These are what we're going to have to do at Iowa State to be really successful. The little things, winning in the margins, that those are truisms. And if we continue to grow and to water those foundations, then we're going to have a chance to continue to have success. But if we don't, if ego starts to creep in and we think that we're just going to win because, you know, we're better than everybody, then it's going to be a really tough road to hoe. So I think really what it did is it showed us how to win and what it takes to win to be successful at Iowa State. And, you know, I give our kids a lot of credit because they've really bought into that. And I think they really understand that if we're only going to push our program forward, it's going to take winning in the margins for us to be successful.
All the way on the left-hand side in the rear, if you would please be sure and stand up so Coach can see you.
Hey, Coach. Kalis Robnett here with the Wichita Eagle and Kansas City Star. With the new rules about red shirts, how do you anticipate viewing and just going about who you play, when you play, and taking advantage of the new rules?
Yeah, you know, I think for me, I core philosophy won't change. You know, I've always told young men that we've recruited, I'd rather play you too late than too early. I don't want to put you in a position that, you know, would rob you of the opportunity to be successful when you're ready to be successful. And I do think that it is certainly a rule that helps a team, especially like our program, where you can develop these young guys in your program, and maybe you get to the months of November and late October when you need some of these capable bodies and guys that have proven that they're ready to play. You can actually put them in the game and help your overall depth in your football team and your football program. So I do think that's really big for us. We put a lot of thought into that, how we'll continue to build our program and how we'll continue to develop those young guys early in their career. But I know it's something that I think would have certainly helped us a year ago and certainly could be a deciding factor for us moving forward as well.
Three quarters of the way back on the right-hand side.
Hey, Coach, Nick Kruger, Rivals.com. Just based on the success that you had last season, what elements were you able to take out of that and kind of push that into your recruiting efforts this year? Are there things that you're showing kids that kind of help you out with that?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing in any coach in the country when they get to a new school, they're selling a vision. Like, that's the reality of it. And I think until there becomes some validity to the vision that they're selling, you're just selling. And so I do think the one thing that's really helped us in our recruiting process now is that we can actually put some reality to this is who we are, this is what we're trying to become, and this is where we're trying to go with Iowa State football. And I think the thing I really love about our coaching staff is we really know what we're looking for in the recruiting process, what fits us, what fits our culture. And, you know, to be able now to tell those young men, this is who we are and this is how we're going to get there, and this is where we're also trying to go, I think that's really helped us. So I think just the ability to give us some reality to what the vision of Iowa State football going forward is going to look like.
Got a question in the front right.
Hi, Jack William Rogers, Reddit CFP. Last week, Iowa State unveiled new uniforms for the 2018 season, and how much mixing and matching will there be between the alternate black and the more traditional cardinal and white?
Yeah, good question. It's been a hot topic in Ames. I think the reality for us, and I'll be the first one to tell you I'm probably not the biggest uniform guy out there, but I do know that we're really excited that, I think it's a really sleek new look. We'll definitely mix and match. We've always done that no matter what uniforms, we've worn, is trying to, let our kids have a great input into what they look like and feel like on game day. I am a big proponent of that.
Question on the aisle.
Coach Pete Mundo, Heartland College Sports. You talk about the vision for Iowa State football. Now that you're here, you have the long-term extension you signed last year. What is the ceiling for this program? And have you looked at another non-traditional, non-blue blood program to try to model this Iowa State program off of?
Sure. I one of my things that I love doing is studying this great game. I don't have a lot of hobbies, so my biggest hobby is football. And, for me, I don't know what the ceiling is. I know what the next step looks like, and that's to add consistency to, a football program. If you want to be a real program, you have to have great consistency into who you are year in and year out. And I think that's the next step for our program and where we want to go and show that we can consistently, become a winner in the Big 12 Conference. I think for me, studying this sport, Boise State, watching, what Coach Peterson's done certainly at Washington, what Chip Kelly did out at Oregon. I think there's certainly some great lessons in our sports on how to, certainly how they've rebuilt Clemson's football program. There's been some really great, I think, lessons learned for young coaches out there if you're willing to go learn and see how successful coaches have built cultures and started to sustain success at maybe, like you said, maybe some not traditional powers.
We got time for one more question, Bryce.
Bryce Cherry, Waco Trib. Matt, you have one of the best running backs in the conference back in David Montgomery. He didn't have a lot of offers, I guess, coming out of high school. Did you know about him from your Ohio connections, and has he even maybe exceeded your expectations?
Yeah, there's a great story to that. David, he did have Toledo as an offer, and then, obviously when we got to Iowa State, he was one of the first names that we put on the board when we got there about, number one, are we going to take a running back? And then number two, here's a guy that not only from a positional need, but stands for what we're looking for to build our football program around. You know, David, my favorite stories at Toledo is we already had two running backs that were committed, but we found out about David at a senior evaluation camp going into his senior year. We actually went down to Cincinnati, Ohio. We traveled. We were there, and he literally is still to this day one of the best camps I've ever seen a running back ever have. And, you know, at that time we didn't have a scholarship available for a running back, but I told him, I said, we're coming back for you. I didn't know that I'd be coming back from Ames, Iowa for him, but I'm certainly glad that he trusted us enough that, you know, he wanted to be a part of that, and number two, that we were smart enough to go back and get David. But, you know, has he exceeded my expectations? I don't think so. I think the greatest thing about David is who he is as a worker, what he is in terms of work ethic, attitude, commitment to be the best version of himself. That's never wavered. And so really nothing has surprised me of why he's been able to have great success, and I still think great things are to come from David Montgomery.
Okay, Coach, thank you very much, and wish you the best for the season.
All right, thank you.